night's homework is in the problem set packet. It's assignment 87, and for those of you that are like, wait, that number doesn't make any sense, last night we just did 110, it's the one that says 87 BC only. It has nothing to do, it has nothing to do with what we're actually doing today. What we're doing is a BC all the way. We are doing that for the next 5 days. Next Wednesday is going to be a review day, and Wednesday night you're going to get the take-home test for this unit that'll be due on Thursday. And then that'll actually put us starting Unit 8, Area and Volume. Love that unit. Love them all. That's because it's like in the top 8. I love being a math teacher, so like it's all good to me. So that's where we are, and I'm not available to stay after school today for tutorials, so I need to go to Southeast. But exciting news, North Central friends, next Tuesday I'm going to get a chance to meet you. So excited, dress up well, brush your teeth, brush your hair, I'm going on Tuesday.
You gotta brush your hair.
Alright, so...
Are you here for
breakfast?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Okay.
As long as you're here for our day.
I mean, it takes like an act of like weather and HISD stupidity to get me to not be here. All right, so homework in the middle of the table. I'm just going to pick that up. And new stuff coming our way. Palimon! Can you read where it says, where we have been? Oh, bad choice on my part. It's on page 21.
Okay.
There you go.
By this point, I tell this is, you should be comfortable with following ideas. Given differential equation, use integration techniques or separation variables to generate a general solution. If you are also provided with an initial condition to generate a particular solution, starting with a word problem involving the straight line variables, direction to directly proportional, inverse proportional, set up the differential equation and generate a particular general solution. Given the slope, field, and initial conditions, sketch the particular solution to correspond to the differential equation.
Okay. For everybody that was following along, are we relatively comfortable with these four things? I can give you a differential equation, you can solve it. Always? You can always solve any differential equation?
No.
No. In our world of elementary calculus, no offense people, this is elementary calculus. We are not equipped with all the tools necessary to solve every differential equation. Very likely you will never reach a point in your life where you can solve every single one of them. Truly. We have separation of variables. Sometimes you get a general solution, sometimes you get a particular solution. I need you to remember all the time that when you are solving a differential equation, your solution has to satisfy two conditions. Andrew, what are the two conditions for your solution? One begins with a C. And ends in untenuous. I'll be telling the jokes today, Carmen. You'd say, oh, sweet niblets. No, I said it started with a C. I lay help him out, going back to the ladies' team here. All your solutions to differential equations must be continuous, and they also have to be... They have to be...
Continuous.
Function. And now in this ideal world where I'm a better calculus teacher, you know that your solution also is going to have a domain restriction attached to it. And on the free response part of the quiz, some of you guys lost that point, and I'm thinking I need to make that clearer when the AV kids take it. But that's where we are. Now, growth models, when like so far, we've only looked at models where we say things like this. The rate of growth of the population is directly proportional to the current population, right? Like if we were talking about like this model problem that we're not going to do, De Rosierberg, it says the town of De Rosierberg founded in 1972. Yes, that's when I was born. 1,000 people moved to the mountains of Colorado. The rate of growth of the population is directly proportional to the population at any time. So if P is my population, the rate of growth, dP dt, is going to be equal to some constant times the current population. Is everybody okay with that? So that's what we've done so far. If we were in a calculus AB class, we would stop here. Now, what happens if you solve this problem out, eventually you're going to get to A equals PE to the RT, because what we're talking about here is an exponential growth model. Exponential growth models say the rate of growth of your population is directly proportional to the amount of your current population. Everybody okay? We went through, we did this once. Anytime you see an exponential growth differential equation, you can jump straight to here. Now, there is a problem with an exponential growth model. There is a real world problem with an exponential growth model. There's no mathematical problem, but there's a real world problem. If you think about modeling your population of a city, of a town in the mountains on an exponential model. Steven, what's the problem?
I can't go up to infinity.
Basically. Right, as if I consider like time approaching infinity, what happens to the A value? If T is approaching infinity, what happens to the number of people in town? The number of people is going to approach infinity. Anybody see any problems with this?
That'd be problematic.
That's a lot of people. I can't invite all those people over to dinner. There's a problem with this being the number of people. Yeah, so many Girl Scout cookies. I couldn't keep up with that. But their issue is, what's the issue? Think about, you are the mayor of this town. What's the problem?
Not enough resources,
not enough stuff, not enough water, not enough space. This is not the real world. Stay with me on this. It's the mathematical world. It is not the real world. Are we good with this?
Yeah.
All right. I like it. Top of the next page.
Next page.
Page 20.
The moralistic model for growth assumes that the growth is bounded by environmental factors such as food or economic factors such as limited resources. In this model, the rate of increase or decrease of the population at time t is jointly proportional to two quantities, y and l minus y, where L is the maximum possible size of the population. This leads to a differential equation, dy dt equals k times y times L minus y. This growth model is called the logistic growth model.
Okay, the logistic growth model is where we are going to spend the next 3 days. We're going to go deeper with the logistic growth model than what you need to do for a Calculus BC course, because I really want you guys to experience this. There are some new words here. First of all, jointly proportional. We've got two kinds of proportionality that we've talked about so far. One of them?
Directly
proportional. One quantity goes up, the other one goes up by a proportional amount. The other one?
Inverse
or indirectly proportional. One value goes up, the other one?
Goes down
by a proportional amount, right? We've got those things. Jointly proportional now means that you're going to have two different quantities. And so what we're saying here is dy dt, which is your, what's dy dt? It's derivative, it's like the rate. Specifically, I'm going to say the rate of growth. The fact that I have k in here is hopefully not a surprise. This is your constant of proportionality. Right? Your rate of growth is directly proportional to two things. Y represents your population. Your current population, I want to be really specific with that. The L is what we're going to consider the limiting population. And so if I look at L minus Y, if Y is your current population and L is the limiting population, then what this says is like the maximum available population. I'll stop and breathe and take attendance and all those things in just a second. Logistic growth models compared to exponential growth models. In an exponential, you say the rate of growth is directly proportional to one thing, and that one thing is your current population. The bigger your population gets, the more it's going to grow. That's exponential modeling. Logistic growth says your rate of growth is directly proportional to two things. One of them is how many people you currently have, how many teddy bears you currently have, and the second is how many more could I actually sustain. We're okay with this thought? Mm-hmm. So like in our little world right now of 10 students, I might go to Mr. Newcomer later today and be like, you know what, next year I can teach as many as 30 Calculus BC students. That 30 is my limiting capacity. Are you okay with that? My current population is the 10 of you. And so what's going to happen, this L minus Y, is how many more could I actually support in this thing? Everybody okay? Celeste, we're good?
20.
20. Good. Now, where are my environmental science folks? AP environmental science folks?
No.
Have you studied yet logistic growth curves?
Yes.
Yes, but not like, we know what they look
like. You know what they look like, and that's about it. So I hope for all my environmental science and my AP environmental science folks, what you know is you guys probably call it the, is it the S-shaped curve?
Oh,
yeah. The S-shaped curve?
S and J.
Yeah,
S and J is exponential.
Right. An S-shaped curve looks something like that?
I know that.
Okay, do you guys still refer to it as the S-shaped curve?
Yeah.
Okay, L. L is this guy up here, right? Y equals L is your limiting capacity.
Oh, over carrying capacity.
It's K.
Or a K?
No, we're not. We already have a K.
Okay. And it would be a C, you big dummy. Carrying capacity.
Oh, wait, she's right.
No, we
not in my house. Okay, so yeah. S-shaped curve, limiting capacity. As time goes on, what happens? Happens to your population?
It approaches, but never.
Right, it approaches but never actually gets to that limiting capacity. This is what we're talking about. I'm going to often give you some value over here at t equals zero, and the fancy name for that is going to be?
Initial condition.
It's the initial condition. And I would assume that in environmental science and AP environmental science, you're just like, yeah, this is kind of like what the curve looks like. And maybe you do some reading things, but she didn't derive it. You don't know where it actually comes from. You just have faith.
Yeah.
We just have faith.
We just kind of believe her.
Okay. Now, here's the thing. In the real world and in the environmental science world, I've seen some graphs that look like that. Have you guys talked about that in environmental science?
Yes.
Somebody tell me, what's going on here? What's going on here? Lewis, what's happening here?
So it's reaching its max and then the population is decreasing because there's not enough resources.
So the population at this point has reached its max. Over here it has exceeded the maximum carrying capacity. What happens?
Those
food.
Those whatever.
No food.
I can't support those things, those animals, those grizzly bears, whatever they are, and they die off. Now, they don't like, boom, die off. They like die off a little bit, and then like we kind of have this wiggling. You guys have a fancier word in calculus for this wiggling?
Oscillation.
Yeah. Oscillation. It's oscillating. Everybody good? We are not going to consider this behavior.
Yay.
We are going to talk about logistic curves, but I need you to understand that in all of our models, we are going to approach the limiting capacity, but we're not going to exceed it. In the real world, that doesn't happen. We actually do sometimes exceed, and then we drop down and we kind of wiggle, wiggle, wiggle.
Is it because
wiggle, wiggle.
Because what? Oh, I think yesterday was better when you guys were just blinking at me. All right. All right, so here's where you got the calculator. Take out your calculator, Polymone, go to your position. Or Polymone, just go. Okay.
No.
All right, and this is where you guys are going to need your calculator.
Hit it.
Okay. There we go. So I'm looking at this example, page 22. Carmen, can you read the example?
Okay. A certain national park is known to support at most 100 grizzly bears. 10 bears are known to be currently in the park. Assume that the bear population is logistic in nature. That is, we assume that the rate of growth is directly proportional to both the population Y and limiting factor L minus Y at any time T. Measured in years, if proportionality constant K equals 0.001.
Okay. We got this is logistic growth?
Yes.
Okay. Partly, they told you it's logistic growth, but I hope the real worldness of this kind of screams at you, logistic growth. Okay, so what I need is the differential equation. I need something that's gonna look like this, and in this case, because I'm being kind, I actually gave everything to you. I did. Do we know K?
Yes.
0.001. What else did I tell you?
You gave us that the...
The limiting factor, the limiting capacity, that carrying capacity is 100 teddy bears? Grizzly bears. I always do that. I always reckon teddy bears.
And then the current population of 10.
Wait, a carrying population of 10?
Current.
A current population of 10, which would mean that at like t equals 0, my population is 10. My differential equation then is going to be that dy dt, Stephen, can all the friends see this? Because they're going to need to be able to see both boards. Dy dt is going to be my k value, my 0.001, times my population, and this is going to be changing. I'm expecting that to be about a variable, times this guy here, 100 minus y. This is just the setup. That's all, that's where we're at right now. Lewis, you okay with all this?
Yeah, I thought it was 100 minus 10, but I see why.
Right, because what we need is, we need this guy here is gonna be your variable, it's gonna change. This is your like current population, this is your initial condition, this is your starting value, okay? So here's what I wanna do. I wanna see how well you guys can graph this differential equation on your calculator. We are not solving yet. Not solving yet. Polymer in the bottom corner, can you zoom in a little bit more? I think it says like a, there's like an option where it says like 100%, maybe you can go up to 200%. Okay. So I want to graph the differential equation. Alright, Polymer, how did that work? Do you remember? Okay, menu. It's the graph entry edit. Graph entry edit, and now get on a differential equation. And this is the part that always messes up my head. It's the graphing, it's entering the stuff on the right hand side. So the equation says 0.001 times, you're gonna actually have to put in the multiplication symbol here. Times, we wrote y, but in terms of your calculator, not x.
Y1.
Because we're talking about y1 prime, the derivative of y, times 100 minus y.
1
minus y.
Y1,
yep. And hit enter. We get a nice little field. Now here's the thing. We're talking about our grizzly bear population over time. I want a slope field that's going to represent that population over time. I want to adjust the window so I can actually see things that I care about here. So right now, the window is going from negative 10 to 10. Probably going negative 10 doesn't make any sense, right, if we're doing a real world problem. Okay, so let's change your settings. Let's make x min 0, x max. If I want to study this population of grizzly bears over time, make it a larger value. Maybe we want to say 100 years. The minimum population, the minimum number of grizzly bears,
10.
Is going to be 10. But let's actually make this 0 so we can just kind of like get a good scale here. And then your maximum is 100. I'm going to ask you to go past 100. Let's go like 120. 110, 120, doesn't matter to me. Check out your slope field. What does it mean? Great question. What does the slope field mean? Celeste, what does it mean?
That there is a horizontal
Okay, there are horizontal tangent lines up here. Any guesses as to where those horizontal tangent lines are happening?
Not X.
Y equals 100 is going to be where you have all these horizontal tangent lines because we know it's a logistic growth curve. Check out your tangent lines. Are they giving you the impression of this logistic growth curve that you would expect? Right? If I have some starting value, like at time 0 there's 10 grizzly bears, the tangent lines tell me I'm supposed to increase forever. No, they're going to have to start flattening out and you're going to get your logistic growth curve. We have no equation yet. That's coming tomorrow. Everybody okay? Okay, how would you actually sketch the solution curve? Anybody remember? How would you sketch the, have your calculator generate the solution curve?
Oh.
Celeste remembers. David, what do you do?
You click tab.
Tab?
And then go to where you wrote.
Yeah, go back up.
And then right there was this X and Y.
Yeah, this is your like X naught, your Y one naught. This is your initial condition. What's the initial condition? But time 0, 10 teddy bears. Grizzly bears! They always become teddy bears! Zero. But then teddy bears makes no sense. They wouldn't grow. And I don't want to think about teddy bear sex. That's disgusting.
Wait,
zero.
I was thinking buying them.
All right. Are like all the things coming together?
Man, that's on film.
Yeah. Right, on film I said don't think about teddy bear sex. That's what I said. That's good. All right.
So.
Okay. Are all the friends okay?
Yes.
Your expertise in environmental science, your mathematical expertise, coming together. All right, C, evaluate the limit as t approaches infinity of y of t. The limit as t approaches infinity of y of t. Has to be 100. Right, we're saying as time goes on, what happens to your grizzly bear population? It gets closer, 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 closer to the limiting population, which is 100. Everybody good? All right, that's as far as I want to go with this part. Part D, if we're lucky, tomorrow we're going to work through part D. It'll take possibly 30 minutes to work through part D. And it's going to involve a couple of calculus steps that aren't going to make a whole lot of sense. But it's okay. You're going to need fresh paper for that. I know, I know. All right, moving on. We got one.
Good for that.
On the side.
We got one more model that I want to introduce you to, and this is over on page 24.
Okay.
Page 24. Lewis, can I get you to read to the top of page 24? And Palimon, you're done. Thank you for your service.
The simplest model of the population growth is dy dt equals ky, according to which population grows exponentially. This may be true over a short period of time, but it is clear.
Okay, hold on, Lewis, you sound like you're racing.
But it is clear that no population can increase without limit. Therefore, population growth. Population biologists use a variety of other differential equations that take into account environmental limitations to growth, such as food, scarcity, and competition between species. One widely used model is based on the logistic growth equation dy dt equals ky times 1 minus y ray. Here k is greater than 0, it is the growth constant, and a is greater than 0, is a constant called current capacity.
Okay, is this any different than what we just talked about? Right, what I just told you is that the logistic growth curve, logistic growth is modeled by dy dt equals k times y times l minus y. This guy over here, they're saying dy dt equals k times y times 1 minus y over a. What's the k? It's some constant of proportionality. And the A? Is the carrying capacity. That's exactly what we were dealing with up here, except we called it limiting capacity. Okay. And why is your population? Now here's the thing that's different. In this model, when you talk about 1 minus y over a, y is how many things you have right now. A is how many you could have total. What this is giving you is a ratio. What they're saying is it's like how many you currently have times the y is how many you have. Like, so like I have 10 calculus BC students right now. A is 30 in my example. So this guy here would represent 1/3. I'm at 1/3 of my carrying capacity. Mm-hmm. We're okay? Mm-hmm. Why the 1 minus? Why 1 minus that 1/3? Think about that. What would that mean?
How many left?
That's what it means?
Like how many left.
Not how many. Like how many, like, don't use the word how many here. This is a ratio. There are 10 calculus BC students. I can support up to 30. I'm at 1/3 of my carrying capacity.
So you can support 2/3.
This 1 minus 1/3 is like what ratio, what percent could I still support? So they look not in like actual numbers here, they're looking at percentages. It's the same big idea, they just, it's a slightly different model. Everybody okay? We got this under control. Good, all right. So I wanna look at a couple of different scenarios of things that could happen here. So this is your like mega slope field. To give you some perspective, we're looking at the equation dy dt equals k times y times 1 minus y over a. Anybody see a horizontal tangent line?
Yes.
Okay, somewhere about here?
Yes.
Okay, where is that? That's y equals what?
5. A little more than 5.
Now, so I understand 5 because you're like, I see 1, I see 2, 3, 4, 5. I haven't given you a scale.
Oh.
So don't make the assumption that it's 5 in this general model. When would you be here at your horizontal tangent line? At A. Y equals A, right? Because A is your carrying capacity. Carrying capacity. There's actually another place where you see a horizontal tangent line. Where?
Zero.
At Y equals 0. Okay, so if we've got like the geography here, we've got y equals 0, we have some horizontal tangent lines. At y equals a, we have some horizontal tangent lines. So what I want to do is I want to think about my initial condition. Imagine I have my initial condition, I'm starting over here. This is going to be some value, I'm going to call it y sub 0. This is somewhere between, it's less than a, but it's greater than 0. If this is your initial condition, trust your instinct. What happens to the solution curve? Follow those tangent lines. What does it tell you? I've picked an initial condition that's greater than 0, but less than A, my carrying capacity. What happens to the population?
It increases.
It increases, like exponential?
No.
No, right. Don't ever fall for that one. You're going to increase, and then we're gonna flatten out. This is your typical S-shaped curve, your logistic model. What if your initial condition is 0? Stop and think about that for a second. Don't talk to me. Stop and think about what this means. You're looking at a population of grizzly bears, caterpillars, whatever, and your initial condition is 0. What does that mean? That means my initial condition is I have like 0 grizzly bears, right?
But then that means
that
your equation can't happen.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that my equation can't happen.
Well, the, like,
I have 0 grizzly bears.
There are 0 grizzly bears to make.
There is no opportunity for growth. There's no grizzly bears. So the mathematical model should be a straight line. What do the tangent lines tell you? Flat line. Y equals 0. I have no grizzly bears. There's no growth. Flat line. V The other time that you get a flat line, if you think about your population, what's the other time you're gonna get this flat line?
When you reach your carrying capacity.
Not if you reach your carrying capacity.
That's
if you actually started at your carrying capacity, you're like, my initial condition is 100 grizzly bears. If that's my carrying capacity, what happens to the number of grizzly bears? 100 grizzly bears. All the time. This is where real world and math world kind of deviate a little bit. You're like, but some die and some are born and they don't die. And okay.
One dies aborted.
Okay. So this guy here and this guy here are called steady state solutions. And I hope the name is a little obvious there. These are steady state solutions because they don't change. Some people also refer to this as like your equilibrium point. I never remember how to spell equilibrium, and I don't care, don't even tell me. Okay.
I mean, is it equilibrium?
Yeah, I can't say that. Okay. Initial condition of zero, no growth. Initial condition equal to your limiting capacity, no growth, because you're constant. Anywhere in between, growth. There's a case that we haven't talked about. What else could happen? What else could happen here? Yes, it does. You could start above your carrying capacity. What happens?
They die.
Is everybody okay with that? This is like.
I mean, I'm not.
I am.
But in a real world sense, if you are above your carrying capacity, there is no choice. You have 200 grizzly bears in a space that supports 100 grizzly bears. What sadly has to happen to the grizzly bears, they die. This is not logistic growth. This would be a decay model. Here we have growth. Okay. There's really one more model possible, which doesn't make any sense in a real world context. But the slope field context should tell you something. Like, what if I started like down here? This is initial condition less than zero, which makes no sense.
Oh.
Right? Negative five grizzly bears, that makes no sense. But what does the slope field tell you? Boom. Decay again. All right, tonight's homework has nothing to do with logistic growth. I'm not ready to push you guys into logistic growth. So it's assignment 87, BC only. We're gonna spend the next 2 days doing some heavy lifting with logistic growth. See you later. And I need all the homework.
Oh God.
I wanna hear it.
We're gonna watch a video later. I'm gonna sing it tomorrow.
It's true.
Ask me about the unit.
And we split up the product. Right, and you're like, I don't know.